The national outcry to end racial injustice has expanded tonight, from protests in the streets to appeals to Congress. The setting was a U.S. House hearing, headlined by the younger brother of George Floyd, who died in police custody last month. Congressional correspondent Lisa Desjardins begins our coverage.
One day after burying his brother George, Philonise Floyd walked into the U.S. Capitol with a message, pleading for justice and action.
I'm tired. I'm tired of pain. Pain you feel when you watch something like that. When you watch your big brother, who you looked up to for your whole life, die begging for his mom. I'm here to ask you to make it stop.
He appeared before the House Judiciary Committee, now working on a bill aimed at police brutality and racial profiling. George Floyd's death sparked nationwide protests and conversations around policing and race. Philonise Floyd was one of 12 panelists at the hearing. Another, Angela Underwood Jacobs, is also grieving. Her brother, Patrick Underwood, was shot and killed in Oakland during protests last month while he was working as a federal officer and guarding a federal building. She, too, called out racism by some and also pointed to blind violence that must stop.
I'm wondering, where is the outrage for a fallen officer that also happens to be African American?
Houston Police Chief Art Acevedo echoed the thought that most police officers are good, but said there is urgent need for reform.
There is no denying that changes in policing must be made. We must acknowledge that law enforcement's past contains institutional racism, injustices, and brutality.
But some Republican witnesses, like Daryl Scott, regularly seen at events with President Trump, were cautious.
And I agree with the fact that police reform, or better yet, police revision should be enacted. But it has to be one that is sensitive to the stress, tension, pressure, and paranoia that policing produces.
The committee will be in order. We will now proceed under the five-minute rule with questions.
The question round, often the most heated, was largely sober and serious. Asked why his brother died, Floyd said Officer Derek Chauvin, who pressed down on George Floyd's neck, knew him.
Yeah, I think it was personal because they worked at the same place. So for him to do something like that, it had to be premeditated.
Authorities have not yet indicated that Chauvin had a personal motive. Also at the hearing, Republicans pushed back at the idea of defunding the police.
If you believe that we should defund the police, will you please raise your hand? I didn't see anyone raise their hand to defund the police. I certainly didn't see any of the Republican witnesses.
Some panelists objected to how the question was asked and said the idea of moving funding into mental health care and community programs is good. The setting itself was extraordinary, in an auditorium in the Capitol Visitor Center to allow for social distancing. This days after congressional Democrats introduced their police reform legislation. Senate Republicans are trying to outline their own plan this week, with South Carolina Senator Tim Scott leading the effort. The pressure on them is not just national. Today it was personal, from heartbroken families. Floyd pointed to how his brother died.
You don't do that to a human being. You don't even do that to an animal. His life mattered. All our lives matter. Black lives matter.
I truly hope that you take your positions, your offices so seriously that you want to go back and really work together and collaborate. Because if you can't get it right, there's no hope for the rest of us.
And Lisa joins me now. Lisa, what a hearing. So you reported there about how the Democrats having made public their legislation, the proposed legislation on police reform. Tell us a little bit more about what the Republicans are looking at.
Well, right now, the Republicans don't have a firm outline that they've made public, but we know behind closed doors, they are talking about some ideas. They seem to be hovering over a few common themes, at least the Senate Republicans. Let's look at those in a graphic here, Judy. First of all, one of those blocking chokeholds. We know that's something Democrats want to do as well. Also, Republicans are looking at some kind of registry of deaths and mistreatment of police. That's a tricky topic for them because they feel that some of them feel states should be governing that, but that is on the table for them. Also, anti-lynching legislation. That is legislation that actually has been blocked by a Republican up till now, Rand Paul, but he seems to be perhaps working with this group to find a way that he can get on board. Also, the idea of a national commission on criminal justice. Judy, that idea from Republicans would be similar to the 9/11 commission in scope. It could take several months, but come up with recommendations. But, you know, Judy, I want to talk about what so far doesn't seem to be in their legislation, but is a heated debate among Republicans. A couple of ideas, particularly about what's called police qualified immunity, which is basically courtroom decisions that have held that police have a kind of immunity from being prosecuted in many cases. Now, Republicans are talking about whether to include this in their bill or not. They're divided right now. It's not in their bill. And then one other thing, the concept of no-knock warrants for drug cases. That is something that could end up in this Republican proposal as well.
So, Lisa, you've mentioned a few names of Republicans involved. Who else? What other Republicans is it known or working on this? And how much urgency do they feel? How quickly do you think we could see something?
You know, I think it's really important to talk about exactly who is in the room making the decisions on this. And as we reported, it's led by Tim Scott. And if you look at the others who are on this so-called task force, here are those names. It is Tim Scott's fellow South Carolinian, Lindsey Graham. He is there, I think, because he is the chairman of the Judiciary Committee. Also, John Cornyn of Texas, Shelley Moore Capito of West Virginia, Ben Sasse of Nebraska, and James Lankford of Oklahoma. These are all people that are thought to have had spent time on these issues before, including past recent criminal justice reform. Judy, I got to say, the urgency and the timing is a bit of a head scratcher. The House of Representatives, the Democrats, are taking their bill to committee next week. They hope to have a floor vote the following week. So the House is on a two-week trajectory to pass major criminal justice reform. The Senate, it is not clear what their time frame is yet. They hope to, again, have an outline, maybe even legislative language this week. But often things can take longer in the Senate than in the House. So we're going to have to see.
For sure. And Lisa, this has been such a wrenching couple of weeks across the country for the American people. We know protests in, 700 American cities. I want to ask you, what's the feeling there on the Hill? Is that coming across when you talk to members? What's the sense of urgency or not there?
I think it's really changed across this week, Judy. Talking to senators on Monday, I didn't feel that the majority of them, Republicans mostly who I spoke with, had a sense of urgency. Some did, like Lisa Murkowski, seemed to be really taking this in and spending a great deal of time trying to figure out where to go. Others didn't have that urgency. I think they do now. I think that's changing. Now, does that mean they can come up with a deal? I don't know.
And finally, Lisa, a bit of news coming from the Capitol late today having to do with House Speaker Nancy Pelosi and Confederate statues.
Right. This is a fascinating story. Judy, the Speaker of the House has written a letter to the group overseeing statues in the Capitol asking that 11 statues of Confederates, these are men who served in the Confederacy, be removed from the Capitol. These particular statues have been selected by states. They're part of the National Statuary Hall collection. Each state selects two people. Most of these statues, Judy, were selected in the beginning of the 20th century. They've been there a long time. But these, again, are Confederates. They include the president of the Confederacy, Jefferson Davis, the vice president of the Confederacy, Robert E. Lee. These are men whose statues are in the U.S. Capitol, have been for a long time. The House Speaker says it's time to remove these statues. And that's kind of a line that no one has crossed before. Until now, they've only put these statues in sort of less prominent locations. One other thing, Judy, this does not, however, include some who were pro-slavery before the Confederacy, like John C. Calhoun, who is depicted in the Capitol four times, including twice outside the Senate chamber. That discussion, I think, will continue.
A lot of people don't realize that.
Yeah.
Lisa Desjardins reporting on what's happened at the Capitol. Lisa, thank you.
You're welcome.